Yes, please.
The Christians like to say that Nabi Muhammad copied because of the stories in the Quran, they copied from the Bible. So, I mean, what is the answer we can give?
That's what I said, that he was only, it's a well recorded fact in the history, that he never could read. So from where he copied, how he copied? If he did not read older scriptures, how? Where is his access to that information? They claim to justify that the trip he went to Syria with his uncle Talib for the business, and in Syria he met some Christian monks and priests, and he had some conversation and he learned. How much person can learn in one journey when he was a young man and even did not announce his prophethood? That after 23 years or I don't know how many years, he came back and narrated all that stories in that manner. Yes. No, that's not exactly the same. Of course, I'd say one
thing. If you copy the meaning, then exactly the same.
Then exactly the same, no? And in fact, there are certain issues which is really, for example, even for us not clear. For example, one of the very amazing thing, and of course, it's Allah's word, we surrender. For example, Quran says that Christians believe Masih ibn Allah, and Jews believe possessing heaven on earth. Now, what does it mean Jews believe possessing? We don't find really this referring to who, because Jews deny this. No, they don't believe something like that. Or what it is referring to? If it was paste and copy job, copy and paste job, sorry. How? Of differences. The personality of Anubhya, you know, that's a very childish that, look how Quran introduces Nabi Ibrahim. Ummata. Ibrahim is a nation in his own. Just think, you're not talking in today after 14 centuries of the civilized world and big, you know, words are easy to talk and easy to... 14 centuries in that Arabian, jahili, ignorant society where absolutely no intellectual development taking place, backward completely, nothing was there, killing each other for most meanest things and smallest of issues. The way Quran speaks about Nabi Isa, the way Quran speaks about Ayyub, how explains their personality, their sabr, their perseverance, their resistance, their reaction, their insistence on Tawheed, their debating about Tawheed. Where in the Bible the personality of Nabi Ibrahim or Nabi Musa? In fact, the most discussed prophet in Quran is Musa. This is an interesting topic itself, that how Quran portrays personality of Nabi Musa. Beautiful, very important. And what is right, for example, how they reacted, what are their habits, what are their mentalities, what are their trends, what are their weaknesses and so on. This whole story of the chosen people, for example, Quran speaks about it.
So then the Quran is more book of the chosen of the sins.
In its real sense, yes. Yes. So this is a very naive and superficial, very surface type of argument. If someone goes through Never say it's a copy-paste job. No way. There is nothing like that in the Holy Scriptures. In this manner, in this particular. The reason is very simple. Because those scriptures are compilation of different people's work and inspiration. The whole format is different format, my brother. Just take simply Bible, Old or New Testament, and take Quran. These are two different things. Bible starts like a story. Adam and this, and Hawa, and this happened, and that happened, and then, you know, it's going on, and then, all that. Quran even does not give us the story of our own Nabi Muhammad. It reflects on the personality and the incidents of the life of the Prophet. But it does not narrate life of the Prophet. He was born there, he became a young boy, and then he became this, and then he married, and then he had a child, and then he slept with this woman. Allah, nothing like that. That format itself is a challenge. It's a unique format.
Muslim sects believe in abrogation of the Holy Quran. Certain verses of the Quran have been abrogated.
Not certain, I'm sure. That's a different distortion. That's not distortion. That's abrogation. Nasr and Mansur. That's a different verse. That Almighty Allah spoke. In fact, maybe we should, Brother Bashir, can we speak about this topic independently, if you don't mind?
Yeah.
Because that's an interesting topic. Because from our point of view, the meaning of abrogation is completely different. We do not believe that Almighty Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala has, just to answer you quickly, cancelled a previous command and issued a new command. No. Our understanding is that sometimes certain command is given in certain conditions, context. Because that context changed, the command changed. So it's not really abrogation, it's not really nasr and mansur. Ayatullah Hui, in that book which is translated in English by Sachadina, what's the end of the question of the translation? Very interesting. What can you remember? Al-Bayan. His first volume, beautiful. There, in that, I will suggest, I will advise. It is available, I think, in our library. Yes, beautiful discussion on that chapter is there. But that's what it is. It's not, you know, contradiction, it's not. It's a two different cards and two different cards.
In fact, they say some verses are only there to be read. It's no more applicable. It's only reading, it's beautiful melody.
No,
it's no more applicable.
No, not at all. We do not agree with that. Yes?
Can I just ask about the Sahdi? Has this been a topic discussed across the ages, or has it only been stirred up during our time as an anti-Shia, you know, attempt?
Look, a little bit, Brother Bashir, my memory is not with me at this moment. But last time when we did a lecture, I think I gave the history. Now, if I'm not mistaken, I think Ibn Taymiyyah is the first person to start this accusation. Or even before him, against Shia. I will check and come back. But it's not this flash that it happened in the last 20, 30, 40, 50 years. No. It's much older than that.
And then the second is that the difficulty in these Shia Sunni debates is when they quote classical scholars, you know, as well as much later scholars of maybe 150 years ago. Mm-hmm. Quote them to say that they believe in Tahrif, but don't quote them meaning to
mean
that different words.
What?
So what I'm saying is in those scholars' books who actually suggest tahrif or kiran, do they actually lay it out in that manner that the tahrif that we believe of kiran was actually in meaning, not in words? Because the way these guys quote out of context it can portray that your own giant scholars believe in tahrif of the words, even though we still read the same Quran, but you know they say that in this Quran there are things missing.
Look, our scholars are also human beings. We do not claim for Shia scholars infallibility. So, maybe, might be certain scholars as a result. Look, there was a, you must understand, there was a that series of Juma discussion about Quran and Sunnah which we had. We mentioned that yes, in Sunni world as well as in Shia world, there was a tendency where they preferred Hadith over Quran. I do not feel shy to say that, unfortunately, that's a deviation in thinking pattern. It took place. It took place both sides of the fence. And the result of that tendency of prioritizing of hadith over Quran produced disastrous results. Now, this particular approach in Shia, yes, sometimes ended in some scholars who took these ahadiths for its literal value of words and said this distortion that did possible. Unfortunately, that is a fact. But mainstream Shia scholars kept this principle that no distortion did not take place. Then there are scholars who are on boundaries. So what I'm saying, there are scholars, even old time people like the feet, Saluk, they said no distortion took place. But then there are scholars, result of, as I said, too much their reliance on hadiths, even more than Quran, resulted that they started to believe no distortion did take place. And then there are scholars who are somehow on the boundary. And they did not leave a very clear cut opinion of themselves, that if they believed in that, what do they mean by that? They were referring to Tahrif Ma'anawi, they were referring to distortion of meaning and diversion of understanding, then distortion of the words. Why this confusion? Because the same typical example of that is Madhusi. Because that is called as again on other books, very firmly they take a position, no Quran can never be distorted. So it becomes difficult to match these two opinions. So therefore, there's a room of yeah. But yes, that tendency is unfortunately ended up in a very, very dangerous situation. Look, this This literalist approach naturally has created disasters in Sunni world also, where anything can be justified by the words of Quran, unfortunately. Killings,
ISIS.
ISIS is an example.
Killing of apostasy. How did the so-called ulama derive this from the Quran?
So that's a different question. What is the meaning of apostasy? Our researched opinion is that Quran, when refers to apostasy, does not refer to the person who has intellectually decided to leave Islam. No. When Quran speaks about apostasy or irtidad, radda, it's not referring to a person who, for his own reasoning and argument which he has in mind, left Islam, but refers to those people who were deviant from Islam for political reasons. In other words, what you call it, treason.
It is a punishment for treason.
Treason. Not for a difference.
Because otherwise, it will contradict free will.
Free will, yes, that's right. And compulsion in religion. Quran very clear, like Rafid Deku. So, again, unfortunately, but that is a part of, I would say, development, evolution of Islamic thought over the centuries, everywhere, not exception, that there are people who understood literally the Quran says, if you turn back from Islam, you must die. But they didn't consider the context. In fact, the word kafir, look, the word kafir in the Quran is anti-belief. Is evil, but it is not equivalent to non-Muslim.
The Jewish map in Medina, Al-Fareza, they were treasonous.
Of course, because they made all the agreements and they were given full freedom to practice their religion.
The thing is, they were not Muslim and left Islam, but it was treason.
Treason.
Treason on both sides.
Both sides, you know. And because they have committed themselves that they will live peacefully and they will not aspire and they will not conspire and they will not do all these things, they continue to do so and became part and parcel of every conspiracy against Islam. That's a different story. It's a political. And there Islam took a very firm stand to stop this scenario and situation. Now, therefore, as I said, the word kafir, which in Quran is anti-Nabi, which is evil, it refers to those who resist on their kufr, not to those people who are on their even wrong faith, but due to what they believe for sure, they have surety. I was talking in Burmese that one of the discussions in our Islamic sciences is Hujjiyatul Qat means you are yaqeen, you are yaqeen. You know yaqeen, what's yaqeen? You know what's yaqeen?
Got the
other one. Yaqeen. Yaqeen is in English. Certainty. Certainty. When you are concretely convinced. Conviction.
Convinced.
Now that yaqeen of yours is proof for you. Are you with me? In other words, you cannot be judged against your yaqeen, against your conviction. If you reach to a conclusion And this is the correct path of thought. Logically, it is not possible for God to punish. Of course, you reached to a wrong conclusion. But you reached. Now, because you reached to that conclusion, it is against justice of Allah to come and punish you.
What if the person is stubborn?
No, 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 then he does not have that certainty.
He is not sure.
Then his arrogance is obstacle between him and acquiring the truth. I am talking about kath. Kath means when you are 100% sure and without any prejudice, without any arrogance, without any stubbornness, without any resistance to truth.
Of challenges by anti-Muslims towards the Muslims.
That's a different story, Quranic, fiction of Quranic. Now, what's your question now? I didn't get it.
Okay. Because we were speaking about Tahrif.
Mm-hmm.
And then, yes.
No, that's an argument. You know, that satanic verses, for example, infiltration. But I think that we have discussed already in the infallibility. That we prove beyond a doubt that no interference of shaitan is possible in the reception and delivery of wahi. So that is Israeliyat, or what we call it, those hadiths or stories which were added and have no value, no authority. Yes, Balaji.
Maulana, you were giving us a lecture previously, you were speaking about a verse in Surah Al-Fat. I think it's a verse, right? Ah. It says that, is any maybe explanation, maybe you can give us who's these two groups,
Maghrub are those on whom Allah's anger. Means those are the people who openly resisted. Very much what the brothers asked the question. And then brother also gives some explanation. Maghrub are those who openly resist. And as a result, they receive anger. They are subject of wrath and anger of Allah. Okay. Dhalleen are not maybe openly opposing Allah, standing against Almighty Allah's will, but again, they are not putting any effort to find the path. Stubbornness, maybe arrogance, maybe other reasons they got stuck in that and they lost. One of all. Maghdub alayhim, those who are involved with Allah, openly involved. You know, we want to shaitan. Openly involved with Allah. Zalim are lost. Lost due to their own shortcomings, due to their own weaknesses.
They are lost. They have a violation of this. Is there maybe any content of Allah that Allah was mentioning about them saying maybe
of course not trying not to speak about living that way, inshallah. That will become controversial.
In fact, Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam did that nicely when he mentioned the present day Muslims will behave like Jews, they'll be like a pair of shoes. Judge the circumstances of the Muslim Ummah today, so called. You see the Jews of previous, exactly the same.
Right, yes.
This point that Nabi Muhammad was put in the Eden, right? So if he was a clean slate, so the Quran can come clean of any external culture.
Yes, yes.
But now, 150 years later, the different Imams, Abu Hanifa, Shafi, they had previous knowledge.
Yeah.
So their madhabs could have distortions in it.
Yes, we don't deny that. That's what I said, there's no exception. There is no exception. And understanding, of course, and for sure it is affected.
That's why
and influenced.
That's why we have all these different madhabs, because
yeah.
If there was no distortion, it would have just been one madhab.
Yes, of course. Yes. But unfortunately, that is the, again, result of free will, you see. Inshallah, as long as you have to announce something, no. Is this